Hello everybody and welcome to today's episode. In today's episode on Grainificent, I will be showing you how to use this Olympus 35RC rangefinder film camera. If you like this type of videos, please remember to hit like and subscribe down below. It shows me I make helpful and interesting videos, and it also shows the YouTube algorithm that my videos are worthy to show to others. So without further ado, let's get into the video. So now let's talk about how to use this beautiful piece of equipment. This is a tiny and comfortable to use, pocketable rangefinder. So if you dream of a cheap rangefinder that is of great build, great quality, that will not disappoint, that has the option to be used without a battery, this is, I think, the cheapest you can get. How to use it? Well, of course, let's start from loading the battery. So of course you need some screwdriver or something to open the battery compartment. And when you open the battery compartment, it uses the 625 model of batteries. I will be making a whole video that, because these batteries are 1.5 volts, you could use them in cameras that were made for 1.35 volt. But it would just show that even if on a battery like this, you would put the needle for perfect exposure, that would underexposure film just a tiny bit. That amount of underexposure should not be noticeable in any photos. So it's not a problem using these batteries. I will be making a whole entire video about these 1.5 volt batteries compared to another battery I found that's technically 1.4 volt, but sometimes when you measure it with a meter, it comes out to 1.35 volts. And with a cheap adapter from AliExpress, you can have those for pennies instead of paying big bucks for the Vine cells. So I will be making a whole video about them, so subscribe and stay tuned for that. But for this camera, I'm using the 1.5 volt Duracell 625 battery. How you load the battery is when you open the compartment. You take this flat side with the ring around it like that, not this flat side, just the wider flat side, and you put it down into there just like this. And then you close the battery compartment. Of course, be careful not to cross any threads. Don't close it too tight. So now since we got our battery loaded, our light meter works in here. The light meter is right here in front of the lens. On the side of the lens, I would say. It doesn't meter through the lens. It meters separately beside it over here. And how you set the ISO for the film you put in there. The ISO is on the side over here, on this side of the lens. And you set it by spinning the inner ring, just like that. ISO setting is not electronically connected to the light meter itself. It actually changes the size of the window that allows the light inside there in the light meter. So there's a bigger or smaller window allowing in light. So it's not electronically connected to the light meter. It just physically changes the amount of light that hits the light meter. So that's also something good because it's less electronics, less things, less connections to go bad, right? So that's how you set the ISO when you set in your film. Staying on the front, we got the self-timer. To use the self-timer, we of course have to advance the film, pull this down, and click the shutter release. And wait approximately 10 seconds. And as we see, it took a photo. Over here on the front, we got our rangefinder window. And over here, we got our viewfinder with the rangefinder inside there as well. So as you see, you got a big, nice, beautiful viewfinder. This is a 42mm f2.8 lens. So it's not too bright, but it is a tiny lens. This is a pocket camera. It's a pocket rangefinder. You can carry it in your pocket and you won't even feel it. Compared to my iPhone 12 mini, well, of course, it's going to be thicker. But I mean, look, the camera is smaller than an iPhone 12 mini. From the smallest iPhone you can find, basically. The camera is smaller than that, and it's on for film. And of course, on the aperture wheel here, it is a little hard to set the aperture here because it's a very thin ring, and usually when you have to set the aperture, you will always basically change your focus because my fat fingers can't grab on just to the aperture ring. As you see, it changes everything along the way. If you would have very skinny fingers, you might be able to change it without changing the focus. So you have to first set your aperture that you want and then focus, because you can't change any settings after you focus, because if you change them, you will have to focus again either way. You have your settings from 2.8 up to f22 for aperture. And you have the off mode, completely off. When you set your camera to completely off, it locks your shutter release. You can't take a photo, even if you advance the shutter. You can't take a photo in the off position. If you change it to any shutter mode, you will take a photo. The next position, the A, is automatic. In automatic mode, the light meter decides what aperture to choose depending on the chosen shutter speed. So in automatic mode, the camera does not control the shutter speed, it controls the aperture chosen. So let's see how that looks like inside the camera. So of course, as we see here on the top, we have our shutter speed selected. Changing the shutter speed, as you see, it changes up on the top there. And on the bottom, we have, when you half press your shutter release, it goes to show you the aperture that you have chosen. In completely manual mode, your camera will take the photo at the settings you have set. It will not change them. So as you see, with the automatic function, when we set our shutter speed to 1/30th of a second, there's too much light coming in, and the shutter will not allow us to take the photo. As you see, we're half pressing the shutter release, and the pointer down below goes all the way to the red and will not allow us to take the photo, because it's too bright, obviously. When we change our shutter speed to, let's say, 1/500th of a second, now when we half press the shutter, it shows us that f11, something like that, is a proper exposure now. So now we can take the photo with these settings, just like that. And on the opposite side of the spectrum, if we don't allow enough light into the camera, for instance, we go to someplace dark and we don't change our settings, we keep it at 1/500th of a second, the pointer down below, again, after half press, will go to the red, and it will not allow you to take a photo because it is too dark for these settings. And if we would lower the shutter speed, let's say for 1/30th of a second, that's still too dark. For 1/15th of a second, there. Now it allows us to take a photo. At 1/15th of a second, it shows about 3.5 aperture, something like that. It allowed us to take a photo. So in automatic mode, it decides about the aperture used depending on your chosen shutter speed. If there's too much light or not enough light, it will just jump straight to red and won't allow you to take the photo. And so the final setting on the ring here is flash setting. So when you set it to the flash setting and you put your shutter speed to 1/30th of a second, that's the flash sync. On this setting, the camera will be in automatic mode, choosing the aperture itself, but you have to tell it how strong a flash you have mounted here. So for example, we have this little tiny, very great flash, Minolta Electro Flash CP. It is a very strong flash. And on this flash, you have the guide numbers set here. As you see, for like, for example, 400 ISO film, it has a guide number of 32 guide number meters or 100 guide number feet. I will be doing a whole separate video about how to calculate exposure if you would use even this camera in completely manual mode. Depending on this, how do you calculate how far is your subject, how to calculate the exposure for this. It's simple, but it's not the point of this video. But you, on whatever flash you have, you check or look up the guide number of the flash you have for the specific ISO. And this camera has guide number settings over here, as you see. In orange, it's in feet. In white, it's in meters. You have to Tell the camera how strong flash you have. 32 guide number meters or 30 or 100 guide number feet. So we would set a similar one here. As you see, we got a 40 and 130. So we would want to set it just to, I would say, the dots between them, because the dots earlier are 65, 28. So 32, 100, I guess, would be in that range there. And to set it, it sometimes is quite hard to set it, because you have to, this little lever, you have to press it in and then change it. So you see, you press it in and then you slide it to a different place. Press it in and slide it. It didn't slide. So yeah, see, just like that. When it locks into its place, it will pop back out. As you see, it's a lever like this. But that tells the meter how strong flash you have. And another interesting thing about this camera is, because we have the guide number set here, and of course, the right exposure is dependent upon how far the subject is away from the camera, right? If your subject is too close, the camera has to adjust for that compared to when the subject is further away, right? This camera in the automatic mode does exactly that. The range meter is connected with the flash exposure. It will change the exposure depending on how far you are focused in. So as you see here, we're focused at 1 meter. We're at the minimum focus distance at 1/30th of a second. In flash mode, it is showing us that after half pressing the shutter, it is showing us we will need almost f22 to block all this light coming in from the flash at this close range. Well, let's keep the shutter halfway pressed in and let's focus out towards infinity. As we're focusing out, you can see now we're focused to infinity. At the same settings, the light has not changed from this view, as you can see, but since we focus the camera so far away, the light meter thinks that the subject is so far away, so it opens up the shutter as much as it could, almost, in order to gather as much light as it could that bounces off from the subject so far away. If we focus closer again, the camera sees that all the subject is closer. More light will come into the camera bounced off the subject from the flash at this strength. So it needs to close down the aperture to about f11, something like that. So as you see, the range finder is connected with the flash. I did try a little experiment though, because I was wondering how much is the flash adjustment in the rangefinder connected electronically with the light meter. As you see, I took out the battery, and in flash mode, the camera still adjusts automatically the required aperture. So you can use it in a basically auto mode without a battery if you have a flash. So if you have a flash, you just do the flash sync and just walk around, focus appropriately, and take a photo, and it should be completely properly exposed. These are all the amazing things this Olympus 35RC can do. And since I already have a flash here, let's take a photo with the flash. You connect the flash and you take a photo, just like that. So of course, what do we have here next? Up next, we have the top of the camera. Of course, we got the shutter release. It does have a thread, so you can connect a shutter release cable to it. We got the shutter frame counter. We got the shutter speeds here. And of course, the red is flash sync. It syncs at 1/30th of a second. We got our hot shoe. And this is your film rewind crank. And on the side here as well, we got a PC port to download the photos to your computer. Of course, that is a joke. The PC port is for a flash sync cable. In case you have a flash that does not use a hot shoe, you just mount it up here and you connect it to the PC port to fire it through here. And going around, of course, here we open the camera. And as you see, we don't have any shutter curtains here because it has a leaf shutter inside the lens. When we take a photo, the shutter opens down there. This camera has an interesting looking 4-leaf aperture. When you change the aperture, you just change a square size aperture hole. Wide open, it goes round, but when you close it down, it turns into a square that gets smaller and smaller because it only has four flat leaves of aperture. So that is an interesting feature. And of course, we got the pickup spool here. We got the shutter crank. We got the viewfinder window with the rangefinder patch in there. And on the bottom, we got the film release button, the battery compartment. And I think that would be all for this camera, how to use it.
So that, my friends, is how to use the Olympus 35RC film camera. It is a beautiful camera with great controls, great functions for its age and size. This is a wonderful camera. It's cheap, it's a rangefinder, and it has a lot of advanced functions that even my Leica doesn't have. If you like this video, please remember to subscribe and hit the like button down below. It shows me I make interesting content, and it shows the YouTube algorithm that this video is worthy of showing to others. So thank you for watching, my friends. Take care, and see you in the next video.